Hi, I'm Michelle Adubato. The North Ward Center is committed to educating the public about the importance of community programs that give all New Jersey residents a chance for a better life. That's why we're proud to support the important educational programming produced by the Caucus Educational Corporation.
Funding for this edition of One-on-One with Steve Adubato has been provided by RWJ Barnabas Health, the North Ward Center, New Jersey Resources, ADP, a comprehensive provider of human resources technology and services, Investors Bank, MD Advantage Insurance Company of New Jersey, and by Caldwell University. Promotional support provided by AM 970 The Answer, and by bestofnj.com, covering all NJ has to offer.
This is One-on-One.
I'm an equal American just like you are.
The jobs of tomorrow are not the jobs of yesterday.
Look at this. You got this?
Here it is, man. Look at it.
Life without dance is boring.
I don't care how good you are or how good you think you are, there is always something to learn.
Do you enjoy talking politics?
No.
People call me because they feel nobody's paying attention.
Our culture, I don't think, has ever been tested the way it's being tested right now.
That's a good question. High five.
Steve Adubato here. This is the 2018 New Jersey Sharing Network 5K. We're in New Providence, New Jersey. Thousands of people are here for this 5K, the gift of life, the sharing network. It is important that you understand the difference they make every day. We interviewed people from an 11-year-old who was here leading a team because he wants to give the gift of life to others, to people in their 70s who received a lung, if you will. He did. He's alive. He's a recipient. His name is Mickey. You'll meet him in this two-part special from the New Jersey Sharing Network. We're at New Providence, New Jersey, the gift of life, recipients, donors, people who care deeply. They're walking, they're running, they're making a difference. You can make a difference as well. Let's do this. We're here with Elisse Glennon, who is Vice President and Chief Administrative Officer of the New Jersey Sharing Network. Another big day. It's the 5K 2018, right? You can hear people already out there. What's so big about this day?
You know, you're right. People are coming in right now from the race. And I'll tell you what's so big about
it. The walk starting at 10-ish?
Yeah, walk starting at 10. The race just went off at 8:30. And here's what's so big about this day. It is cloudy. It's cool, right? Star Spangled Banner to start the race this morning. The sun popped out during the song and then went away when the song was over, because that's how big this day is. The people here are very special. They're here celebrating their loved ones who passed away and donated their organs. They're here celebrating the lives of the recipients whose lives go on because of that legacy. And every year, something special, like the sun coming out during the Star Spangled Banner, happens every year.
You know, it's interesting. We've been doing this for several years together, and I was telling my wife that it's not the same because they aren't the same people. They're not the same stories. And we use stories. It sounds like, oh, you're telling a story. This is the gift of life being given again and again and again by so many different people who may never have expected that they were part of this chain, if you will, right?
Right. That's right. And yeah, people never expect to be part of this club. People don't want to be part of this club. You don't grow up thinking that maybe one day my loved one will be an organ donor or that I'm going to need a transplant. It's a pretty scary thing. Nobody wants to be part of this club. But once they are here, we do provide, we meaning the Sharing Network, our volunteers, our staff, and the fellow donor families and recipients, provide such a level of support and comfort and family and camaraderie that it's very special. It's a special thing to be a part of.
It's interesting because you're saying no one wants to be a part of it, but your husband, he chose to be a part of it. Tell folks the version of that.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. There is a group of people that come here.
He was an altruistic donor, right?
He was. He donated his kidney to a stranger, and it was really because of meeting all of these inspirational families
today.
Here. Right. Yeah. He's been coming to this event for 8 years. He's participated in other events, and he just continued to get inspired and just felt like he wanted to be part of it. So you're right. There are people, particularly the living donors, who want to be part of this. You know, if those other families, the donor families and the recipients, can get up every day and continue to advocate for organ donation and continue to pay it forward, why shouldn't he? And yes, he decided to save someone's life, to save a stranger.
It's not just one person. Talk about the because he was part of a chain, if you will. Help folks understand that.
Sure, sure. Many times a kidney recipient or a patient waiting for a kidney, rather, has a loved one who is a willing donor, but they just don't match. So they can enter what's called a kidney chain, and a kidney chain can only start by a volunteer donor, so to speak, an altruistic donor. So Brian gave to a kidney recipient who had a willing donor, but they just didn't match. So their willing donor then gave to a stranger who they did match. That stranger had a willing donor, and so on and so on. So That's the chain. It could just be a simple paired exchange where two couples just swap kidneys. You can have a chain like this. So Brian's chain so far is up to 22 donors and 20.
We thought it was 15. It's 22?
We thought it was 15. We thought that the chain ended, but the chain has continued. So much to our surprise, he found out last week, actually. So
we can say that officially.
We could say officially 22 donors, 22 recipients so far. As far as I understand, the chain may still continue. So we'll see. He's going to have the chance for the whole chain to come together and meet each other on June 11th.
June 11th, actually, that's on the Today Show.
Yeah, well,
do they have an audience? Because I know we do. Does Today Show have anyone watching? So he's on with Megyn Kelly doing that.
He's on with Megyn Kelly to meet his recipient. But that evening...
And you'll be there.
I'll be there in the audience along with the Barnabas team. But that evening, the entire chain, all 22 donors, 22 recipients, and their families will get together and meet for the first time. So just a few of them will be on the Today Show.
Before I let you go, 2020 Transplant Games, big deal, isn't it? What is it and why does it matter?
We're really excited about this. The Transplant Games of America occur every 2 years. It showcases transplant recipients in sporting events, showing that transplant works and you can lead a very normal life post-transplant. And they include living kidney donors as well, again, to show that you can lead a very normal, healthy life.
Where's it happening?
So we bid to have the games here. It's going to be hosted in the Meadowlands in 2020, so in 2 years from now. The games are every other year. This is a national event, typically gets about 7,000 to 10,000 people when it's somewhere else. But this is Jersey. We do it big here. So we estimate that we'll get upwards of 20,000 people in 2020 to come together. Now, it's not just for transplant recipients and living donors. Donor families are encouraged to come and support. In fact, the donor families are the ones that put the medals on the recipients when they win their bronze, gold, and silver.
It's a big deal. And by the way, just to disclose, recently Elisse joined the Board of Trustees at the Caucus Educational Corporation, and the difference you make every year is extraordinary. Congratulations.
Thank you so much, Steve, and thanks for being here again.
Brianna, it is so good to meet you. By the way, you're a fellow Newarker from Brick City, right?
Yes, I am.
Tell folks why you are in this 5K today and the very personal and powerful connection to your church and the gift of life that you gave.
So I am with the Sharing Network, and I'm volunteering today because of my faith-based values and the fact that, I come from a really strong religious background, and that kind of gave way to me wanting to donate. I donated to someone in the church, choir director. I was in college at the time, and then I graduated, and I came back home, and I was like, he's really sick. And I asked, I said, what do I have to do? So I went through the testing, and there wasn't a time that I even second-guessed it. It was just something that I wanted to do. I was like, could we do it next week? And they're like, no, you have to do the testing. So that's it was really heartfelt, and now we have such a great connection. And, he has a set of young triplets, and I'm like, every family, every child needs their father.
Your daughter is with us today. She is 3, and you are, in fact, turning 27 as we do this program. I think to myself, and by the way, I know the church, St. James AME Church in Newark, historic, iconic church, if you will. But I'm curious, your faith drove this?
Absolutely. For some reason, I just could not get this out of my head. And I knew
that he was suffering, the choir director.
Yes, that he was suffering and that there was something that someone could do. And I know, you pray to God for things, but we have to act on them. So when I prayed and I asked, what should I do? That was the time that I heard most clearest from God that this is what I need to do. This is one of my purposes in life.
We were talking before we got on camera that the issue, the problem, if you will, the challenge is connected to organ and tissue donation, prevalent all over. thousands, tens of thousands of people waiting, I believe between 4,000 and 5,000 in New Jersey. But it's a unique problem in the African American community because
there are many misconceptions, a lot of myths, and if I could be that person to just educate, you know, I'm not trying to change anyone's perception of organ donation, but I would like to bring education to the community and just to kind of give myth busters.
Go back to, like, just let's put it out there, because part of what we're doing with the Sharing Network is trying to deal with those myths, clarify those myths, correct the incorrect, if you will, assumptions. Some of the assumptions we don't want to perpetuate, but we need to take on directly about organ and tissue donation include?
So one thing that I hear very often is that, you know, sometimes they'll just let you die in the hospital if they want your organs. That's not true. In fact, less than 10% of people who, you know, pass away in a hospital, their organs are actually usable. So there are criteria that need to be fit, or, you know, things that need to be done in order for that organ to be recovered. So, you know, you have to be in a hospital, and you have to die on a ventilator. You have to be brain dead. So there are things that come with organ donation. It's not just, you know, someone coming and taking your body parts. And I know that there's, you know, I hear a lot about the black market and, you know, killing people for their organs, or, you know, kidnapping them. So I'm going to educate myself.
All that stuff is just wrong. It's wrong. But if you go on the Sharing Network website, which is up right now as we're doing this interview, people can find out how they can donate, how they can give the gift of life in a way that it's an extraordinary difference.
Right, absolutely. And this is just, a living donation is much different from, you know, a deceased donation. This is something that you willingly do. And if you have to second guess, maybe it's not for you. But if you know for a fact that you're going to save a life, that should be no question.
We're here with Chris at the 5K, the New Jersey Sharing Network 5K. Chris, talk to us. We're looking at your shirt, Joey's Sour Patch Kids. Talk about that.
Joey passed away in March.
Your son.
My son, Joey, passed away in March of 2016. So we did the first 5K in June of 2016, a couple months after he passed away. And we needed a team name. And Joey is 28. He left us a beautiful daughter. And him and Ariana love Sour Patch Kids. So a couple days before the race, we needed to pick a team name, and Sour Patch Kids it was. So this is our third race in honor of Joey. He donated six organs. We met his heart recipient in this past November.
What was that like?
It was a beautiful experience. It was right around the time of what would have been Joey's 30th birthday. So we met Jeff, and it was very emotional for all of us. My husband and my two granddaughters were there, and Jeff and his entire family. And it's beautiful and comforting knowing that Joey lives on. And the six recipients, from what I understand, we've been in contact with three, but from what I understand, all of them are doing well. And it's absolutely amazing that he lives on in others. We got to listen to Joey's heart the day we met him here. And
how did you do that?
Well, with Joey's stethoscope. Joey was an EMT for many years here. He had an amazing rescue in 2010 where he saved a woman's life. And he
spent his life helping other people.
Yes, he worked as an EMT. He was... Both my husband and I are EMTs, and he just fell right into it.
Your husband's at University Hospital?
University Hospital EMS, yes. Joey worked for McCabe Ambulance in Bayonne, and he always, in any picture he had or anything, it was always with the stethoscope around his neck. And we used that stethoscope to listen to his heart in his recipient, and it was absolutely amazing. It was a beautiful experience. It was very peaceful. Very reassuring, and it gives us hope that out of darkness there's light. So he's helping others even in death as we are here remembering all he did.
The sun comes out as you're speaking. Yeah. you noticed that?
Yeah, I feel a little warmer.
Yeah.
That's Joey. He's around.
Are there signs?
He's here. Oh, absolutely.
There's really?
A lot of signs, yeah.
Share, please.
Oh, God, there's just so many. We... The best sign that we have is Joey loved to do tree work all the time. And he kept telling me there's a tree in the yard, that tree's got to come down, the tree's got to come down, and I ignored it. Well, right after he passed away, I happened to be out in the yard, and I'm like, that tree's got to come down. So we took the tree down, and within 2 weeks, out of that tree is growing another tree. So we have a tree about this size that has grown in 2 years.
Right behind us is a tree.
Is a tree, yep. And in 2 years, we took that tree completely down, and all of a sudden, out comes another tree. By the end of that summer of 16, we had a tree. And I kept saying, I should have listened to him.
He was a smart young man.
He was, yes, he still is.
Chris, finally, the message you have for everyone watching right now, as we put up the website for the Sharing Network, what is it?
I could tell you that when Joey turned 17, he went down for his driver's license, and I said, did you pass? And he said, I just want to let you know I registered as an organ donor.
He did that on his own at 17?
All on his own. And I said, well, did you pass? All I'm thinking of is, oh, there goes my insurance.
He's thinking about other people.
And he was thinking about others. And when it came time to make that decision, we respected that decision, and we knew that he would live on. So organ donating is absolutely amazing. It keeps us going as a family, knowing that he and everybody else and many people. We've met many people through this walk. And organ donation is absolutely amazing.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you.
To watch more One-on-One with Steve Adubato, find us online and follow us on social media.
Every year when you come to the Sharing Network, you meet some amazing people. This is Siomara Hernandez. It's so good to see you. Who are you with here?
My aunt Blanca Hernandez, Pastore.
Hi, how are you?
I'm doing great. And the name of your team is Team Bimbo. Talk about that.
Our team is in honor of my cousin Orlando, Orlando Marrero. He passed in March 12th of 2016. He was only 34. And he was always giving. He would be the first one of charity cancer, charity for everything. He always had a team. He was always helping everyone. And after he passed, last year was his first year, we did a charity for the New Jersey Children's Alliance. And then this year, we felt a little more ready to do the walk. So we wanted to do it this year, so we did our team. And I came in from Puerto Rico. I started the team in Puerto Rico and started organizing it over there. And then flew in, and we just got set up.
Hold on. You brought a team from Puerto Rico to be here in New Providence, New Jersey. Hold on.
Puerto Rico here, because they're mostly here.
But she organized it.
She organized from over there and came back.
And talk to us about your connection here.
Well, Orlando was my nephew. She's my niece. And it's true exactly what she said. An example of it, of his giving, is there was someone that he worked at an auto shop, and someone came in from Florida, didn't have a car. She was a single mom. And Orlando would take her every day to work, and on Wednesdays would take her food shopping because he knew she needed help. So that's just the type of soul he was. And we just feel that this is such a good way to honor him, to honor and to keep the legacy that he was. He was always giving.
He would be so proud, wouldn't he?
Yeah.
Talk to folks right now watching who want to help, don't know how to help. If they went right on the Sharing Network, I don't mean to make you cry, by the way. if they go on that Sharing Network website right now, what should they do?
They can help by signing up as donors or just by donating, like contributing, helping so we can help others. Just being a part of it.
By the way, why is this especially emotional for you? You were close to your cousin, weren't you?
He was my cousin, but it was like my brother.
He was more like a brother.
Yeah, they lived together.
You can make a difference. I don't want this to sound like a cliche at all, but out of terrible tragedy, excuse me, and suffering, people can make a difference, can't they?
Absolutely. And that, I think, it was a very sudden death.
34 years old.
4 years old.
He woke up, went to work,
collapsed
at work.
We had 4 days to say goodbye. And it was 4 days that it took us to make the decision. My sister was very emotional for all.
His mom.
His mom, Sally. And it took us the 4 days to make the decision. We realized he was a donor. We weren't surprised because, like we said, he was a very giving person. And when, you know, we did the decision, I have to say the Sharing Network was very holding our hands the whole time, no pressure. They were very, very good to us and the family. They took very good care of us. And when the time came, we
decided to pass on his own. He was so good, we didn't even have to do it. He decided to go on his own.
We thank you so much. You're making a difference. Thank you. We're talking to Mary, who is the team captain of a team called Cindy's Amazing Grace. Tell us about this.
So my mom, Cindy von Schmidt, passed away in 2016 from a brain aneurysm. And we named our team after her, obviously. Her favorite song was Amazing Grace. But we thought it really tied into the 5K Celebration of Life to name our team Grace, but Race. So
yeah, look at the logo, folks. Let me get this right.
It's Cindy's Amazing Grace. And then we just kind of did a play on words with race.
Your mom, she was only 55, if I'm not mistaken, a brain aneurysm. Had she talked about giving the gift of life?
So we actually were not really familiar with organ donation prior. She was signed up with the national registration. However, it was nothing that we really discussed. She was 55, young, healthy, fit. We never discussed what are we going to do if you pass of a brain death. So when the opportunity arose in the hospital, I won't lie, I was a little nervous. I was not very excited thinking about what are they going to do to her? I was nervous. Of course, my dad and my brother said yes, absolutely, immediately. I had a lot of questions and concerns, and they were put to bed almost immediately with the bedside manner of the New Jersey Sharing Network explained everything.
You didn't even know who they were before.
I had no idea. And now I sit on a council for the network, and I do what I can to raise awareness and spread the word because it's an absolutely amazing thing, and people need to know about it.
You know, I'm curious about this. Your smile, your enthusiasm, your passion. There are some folks who might say, listen, if that were to happen to me or a loved one, I couldn't think about anyone else. I would only think about my own terrible situation, you say?
Yeah, I can see that a little bit. But honestly, this is the best thing that could have happened to a horrible scenario. I mean, the death of her, of my mom, was horrific. It was nothing I had ever expected. She passed on Valentine's Day. I was at work, and I expected to come home and have a family dinner, and I didn't. I got a phone call in the middle of the day, and my dad said, my father's blind, and he said, I think mommy might have had a seizure. She's in the ambulance. It's going to be okay. Come meet us. And I said, okay. My day stopped. I rushed out to the hospital. I met them. They said, you know, actually, it wasn't a seizure. We believe that she had a brain aneurysm. And we were like, well, now what? And that's when the Sharing Network came in and introduced themselves. And like I said before, at first I was nervous. But now I couldn't be more grateful. To me, you could be sad or you could keep. She gave the ultimate gift. And now it's my turn to make sure that people know about it. Not just her, but the network in general and the amazing work that they do. They save lives.
And she saved lives. Talk about that.
My mom donated her lungs, her liver, her kidneys. She's helped multiple women with breast cancer reconstruction surgery through tissue donation. One thing that I find really amazing is, I said, my dad's blind. She helped a child see again by donating a cornea. So she was my father's eyes for over 20 years after he lost his vision. They were married for 35. So after that happened, she was his eyes. And in death, she was someone else's eyes now, which I get goosebumps thinking about it and talking about it. But how amazing is that?
Absolutely amazing.
Mm-hmm.
One more quick thing before we bring the team in. On the sleeve, can we get a shot of this? On the sleeve, that is a gingerbread. It's not a man. It's a woman,
yeah. Gingerbread woman.
What is the significance of that? Because I know your mom, as I read about her, loved to bake.
Mm-hmm. So my mom was passionate about a few things. She was passionate about baking, number one, though. She had a full-time job that she did, but she also loved to bake. From October to after Christmas, she was in the kitchen, and we were baking together. We baked over 30 different kinds of cookies, candies.
I'm sorry, you're talking about your mom, but I see your team coming in. She baked. Go ahead.
And then we sent those cookies all over the country and actually all over the world. My big brother's a Marine. Unfortunately, he couldn't be here today. He's on duty. But
thank you for your service.
Thank you. And so we have friends all over the world in different bases. And so
this is the team.
Yeah. And this is my dad right here.
I'm Steve.
Hi. Good to meet you.
I'm sure you're proud of your daughter.
Very.
And so we send cookies all over the world to different bases, Belgium, Germany, Afghanistan, Iraq. Our cookies have been there. Her cookies have been there. And so it's a big deal for us. We all miss the cookies. We miss her, but we miss her cookies too.
I can't, on behalf of everyone in the public television family, and we just want to say thank you for everything you're doing and the gift that your mom gave to so many others and to all of you for participating in this great race. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and we thank the New Jersey Sharing Network for being here, because if it weren't for them, we wouldn't be here.
And everybody else can make a difference, can't they?
Absolutely. Sign up.
Everybody.
Go ahead. One more thing. Go ahead.
Everybody should sign up.
No excuse, right?
No excuse.
You can't be too old. You can't be too young. Sign up.
Thank you.
One-on-One with Steve Adubato has been a production of the Caucus Educational Corporation, celebrating over 25 years of broadcast excellence. Funding for this edition of One-on-One with Steve Adubato has been provided by RWJ Barnabas Health, the Northward Center, New Jersey Resources, ADP, Investors Bank, MD Advantage Insurance Company of New Jersey, and by Caldwell University. Transportation provided by Airbrook Limousine, serving the metropolitan New York, New Jersey area.
How do you create change? By cultivating hope. And we see that every day. In the eyes of our preschoolers, in the souls of the seniors in our adult day program, in the minds of the students at Robert Treat Academy, a national Blue Ribbon School of Excellence, in the passion of children in our Youth Leadership Development Program, in our commitment to connections at the Center for Autism, and in the heart of our community, the North Ward Center, creating opportunities for equity, education, and growth.